Welcome to the Center of Light Radio with spiritual teacher, intuitive, musician, composer, and best-selling author of The Divine Principle, Anchoring Heaven on Earth, your host, Keith Anthony Blanchard.
Coast to coast, pole to pole, all around the world on the internet. I'm coming at you live from my guest house in Memphis, Tennessee. This is Keith Anthony Blanchard. The music you hear just before every broadcast is my spiritual group called Lavender Soul. What a fun project that is. It's made up of members of the Memphis Symphony Orchestra. And we haven't done a project in a while, but maybe we can make that phone call and get some things going and maybe do another album. That would just like be really, really cool. Tomorrow night, 8 o'clock Central Time, if you are available, go to facebook.com/KeithAnthonyBlanchard. I'm going to be doing a Burst of Light live feed. I find these really cool topics, and I get people in the room, and we just go at it, and it's really, really fun. And tomorrow night, we're going to be talking about Brian, I guess Brian, and maybe talk about some of this tonight. We're going to be talking about avatars, godmen who have walked the earth. While you're out and about on the internet, go to centeroflightradio.com and look at the opening page. You see a subscription form. Fill it out. I do a newsletter installment monthly, empowering you with lots of really, really cool things, things that expand me. And I, in turn, like paying that forward and giving that to you. I do all the research. And in the future, if there's something you want me to research, I'll be glad to chase that rabbit as far into the hole as possible. I'll bring my gold shovel, so when I hit the end of the hole, I'll dig a little further. And I put a lot of time, lots of hours, into this newsletter program to bring you and myself. It's a great discovery for me as well, powering information that can change your life for expansion, not because you're broken. Because you're not broken, just because it's fun, and it's also empowering, and it'll bring you a lot more bliss in your life without all the effort. People who have done the work. You know what? I got a couple of adverts I was going to do, but we're going to get right down to the show. I was supposed to have Mr. Derek Rydahl on Center of Light Radio tonight, and there was some email dropouts here and there and some things that just didn't happen. So as a backup plan, I got my bro Ham, Mr. Brian Hardin. We got a fantastic show for you tonight. It's going to be kind of like a free-for-all, just to dance and see where things go versus laying into a particular subject. Let me tell you a little bit about my guest, Mr. Brian Hardin. Brian says, I am addicted to thought and addicted to creativity. I am always making something. Boy, his life and mine parallel very well. Studying something or playing something, I believe that imagination is more important than knowledge. Dig that. I try to play more than I think. I follow my intuition, my heart, turn off the judgment, including judging myself. I've been blessed to be able to meditate and be in ceremony with many great elder leaders, Lakota, Hopi, Mayan, Tibetan, Inka, Mexican, Zuni, Mexica. Navajo. Yeah, thank you for that. And Cherokee, he loves focusing on and sharing messages of hope and understanding to the world. He is obsessed with creating great projects. Gosh, we share the same path in that way. And sharing a clear explanation of what changes are happening to humanity and how we are all unifying and collectively raising and shifting our consciousness. You could find my phenomenal guest you're going to be hearing tonight at brianhardin.com. My brother, welcome to Center of Light Radio.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much, Keith. Hey, I also have a thing called New Ways, spelled with a K, like you know something, K-N-E-W-W-A-Y-S. And my purpose with that is the same as why you're doing what you're doing. It's the evolution of consciousness. It's giving us all, exposing new ways of us all learning and growing and sharing and connecting and unifying and seeing the old patterns that don't work in ourselves and creating new ones. And that's what you're doing. You know, thanks.
Like you, I just love it. I love waking up when I wake up in the morning, seriously, bro, I might have to eat something if I have to. Point is, I just can't wait to get out of bed and turn on my 48-inch Sony TV screen, which is my computer monitor, and seeing what mail emails are coming in and just seeing what up to no good I can get into, bro.
Well, hey, tell me about your morning ritual, because this is actually really important. We're all set of patterns. So when you set the pattern of having an alarm screaming at you, and then you're in a panic mode, and then you rush off to make it, to barely make it to work and sit in traffic and all that other stressful stuff. It sets the tone for being stressed out every day, all day, and being in an edgy way. And so do you do anything to calm yourself down and keep yourself tuned into nature and the right path? How do you do that?
Honestly, Brian, all I do is just wake up. When I wake up, I have nothing I have to do. Nothing, not a thing. You know, once in a while, something will come along. I have to do a certain errand or go pay this bill or run to the post office kind of thing. But my daily life does not revolve around the system. People say, Keith, you are so busy. How do you find the time to do all those things you do? And I said, when you're doing what you love, time will find you. And I get up in the morning, I start creating a working my website or finding guests for the radio show or putting YouTube videos up, doing bursts of light. As I mentioned at the beginning of the show, we're going to be talking about Godmen tomorrow night. So this is how my life is unfold. You know, I play music nightly. I do acoustic music all over the city of Memphis on the weekends. I'm a weekend warrior with my rock band, Grand Theft Audio. And bro, I couldn't possibly envision my life being any better. So I get out of the way of trying to create it and just let the universe bring me all the goodies I deserve.
Well, you're one of the few other people I know that is actually living that way. I live that way, and it's really hard. People say, oh, you've got it so easy. It's really hard to be this connected to nature, this connected to being natural and living in tune with whatever I feel, as opposed to being on a schedule and in a system that never has worked for me. So do you have any keys for what you've given up for all that? Because that's I've got a whole list of things that I've had to give up in order to get this freedom. And it's an interesting thing. Can we talk about that?
What a fantastic question. That was never put to me, and I've never, ever considered or entertained that question, because it truly is not part of my design, not part of my life, not part of my divine script. To be really honest with you, there was nothing I had to sacrifice. Well, sometimes I have to sacrifice seeing my son an extra day or something like that, but as far as a major a giving up of something, yeah, the illusion of having to go to a job and doing all those things you described 5 minutes ago that bring nothing but loathing into people's lives. So, and I don't call that living. I call that existing. So I never had to, quote, really sacrifice something to be this musician, this creative, artsy type of person. I blessed that I am, yes.
I actually have a quote that I like to use, and it's to act naturally, not normally. The system we're in is what most people consider normal. And Chris Hedges actually is a writer, and he said, we now live in a nation where doctors destroy health, lawyers destroy justice, universities destroy knowledge, governments destroy freedom, the press destroys information, religion destroys morals, and our banks destroy the economy. And that's a system that I am in belief that we're all working together to change all of it. And, you know, they say evolution, actually, for all species, evolution favors those who are adaptable to change. And so we're changing our healthcare, our justice, our education system, our freedom and government systems, our religion, and our economic system. We're having to do that now. This is what those, you know, when all the programs are talking about 2012 and the end of the world, well, it was the end of the world as we know it, in a new beginning of a world that works for all, unity and compassion and love and working together, because we either have to work together to evolve our consciousness, or we will destroy ourselves and the entire planet that we're on as a result of our stupid behavior, these old patterns. So we have to change to the new patterns of being in harmony with nature and each other. Do you agree?
Man, I couldn't have said better for sure. When we get out of the fight, I say this a lot, the fight with the world, fighting the world, fighting yourself, fighting with internal dialogue, all these different modalities of fighting creates rapids. It's like the rocks in a stream. It's resisting the stream. So it creates turmoil. It creates anxiety. It creates unwanted things in one's life. So I often use the statement, get out of the fight, because when you do, you become harmonized with that which is natural. You become consciously aware of it. You finally get into the flow of it. And fortunate, as I mentioned, pat Keith on the back for the work I've done in my life, I was able to ease my way into the cosmic life stream. And I find myself now to this very day living without effort.
What, do you have any tools for manifestation that you use to keep it in the flow?
I do the things that everyone knows to do, ever you may be in the spiritual movement. I do visualization, but I don't make it difficult. I see something I want, and I go for it. And I go for it. It could mean, you know, getting there and doing the work if it involves my computer, getting there and doing the work if it involves me doing something with the rock band. So I don't just think. I don't just visualize. I don't just talk. That's a phenomenal word. I engage. I engage every fiber of my being. And so people say, Keith, when you bring these projects, are you sure that when you want to bring this about, this is going to happen? There is no room in my life for something not to manifest. That is the magic. There's no wiggle room, for sure.
I have some funny tools that I use. First of all, you know, we're connected to nature, and we disconnect ourselves to nature in this system that we were just talking about. Our healthcare system, like, you know, the food system doesn't take into consideration. Well, actually, the healthcare system doesn't take into consideration the food that we're eating, and the food doesn't take into consideration the health that we need. And so the two of them work together to actually destroy us. What's actually delicious is not necessarily nutritious. And same thing goes for our education system. The old paradigm way of teaching people was to go to the library and whatever else, and, you know, check out a book and read that. But these days, everybody's got a little black box on in their hand, and they can get the information of the world at their fingertips within seconds and watch a video that explains what a book couldn't do in 300 pages. A video in 3 minutes can explain what a book couldn't in, you know, 300 pages. So anyway, we have information, we have physical stuff challenging us too. And so with all that, we've got to change our paradigm, and it's the whole paradigm. It's and what comes with that is the evolution of our consciousness, where we all start thinking about we instead of me. And most of these companies these days now that are big think in that new paradigm way, which is, how can we create a win-win-win situation for everybody that's involved? And the old paradigm way was, you know, business, it's just business, you know, don't take it personally. And the new paradigm way is, how can we come together and connect and evolve to do something what's right for everybody that's involved, including the consumer? So, you know, I have Gmail, and it's been free the whole time. I also have YouTube. It's the same company, and it's free all the time. And now, how can those companies, you know, the company Google and so on, give away all this free place for video, free email and so on, and still make a living is, you know, information age. And so it was a new paradigm way of looking at things. Banking was PayPal, and that turned into a big thing. So if you can evolve your business and yourself, you will be part of the evolution of this new wave of thinking and feeling. And it's really feeling. Because really what you do when you wake up, you feel the feeling. You go to the feeling of, I feel good, I'm in love, I'm happy, and I'm yeah, going to be successful. So you go to the feeling. Whenever you're playing guitar, you go to the feeling of the tone and the feeling you're putting out into the world. And so if you choose to have a bad feeling, your guitar solos are going to suck. And same thing with your life. If you have a, if you focus on the negative and the fear and the negativity and watch the news, your life is going to revolve around that. You have two choices, yum or yuck. And so if you focus on yum, then you're not focused on yuck. And that's part of your manifestation thing. It keeps you in the positive energy. And then when you're positive, you attract that same positivity. Is that correct?
Completely, bro. Completely. Just a bit ago, you were saying, you were talking about one of the systems that you called out was the education. You know, I think somewhere in Denmark, Holland, don't quote me on the location, but somewhere in that region, they are no longer having their kids go to school however many hours a day like they used to do here, like, and also it's taking place here in America. The kids are going to school for like 3 hours. There is no homework. They give them recess. So they just completely removed a lot of this extraneous learning for the kids. And everyone in the whole system in the region, whatever location this is, their academia is going through the roof. It's going off the charts. You know, something I said recently.
It was New Zealand. Yes.
And I said it's all backwards. Education should not be about children conforming to the system. Instead, it should be about the system expanding to the children's way of learning.
You know, with all the information at our fingertips, literally at our fingertips these days, there's no reason for me to remember most of the stuff that the old paradigm wanted us to remember. Instead, we should be enticed to use that information creatively, not to regurgitate crap, but to actually use the information to evolve and to change and to cut a new edge for all of society. And so most of our school system is programmed to not thinking that way. It's not the teachers that don't think that way. The teachers actually want to be able to teach that way, but they're thrown into these systems like Common Core and whatever, where they've got testing and whatever else.
How ridiculous
else
was that?
Common. Oh, yeah, the whole thing's ridiculous.
Common Core, really? Do you see some of these equations to get to the simple root of something that you can just, I didn't follow it. I just knew there was a bunch of humbug behind all that.
Mm-hmm. Well, think about it. It's actually crazy making. It confuses the people. And most of our systems confuse the people. What we talked about in that quote by Chris Hedges was lawyers destroy justice is part of that, too. Think of the legalese in the wording with legalese to confuse you. It's purposefully set up to the to make you not understand. And religion used to be that way. Thee, thou, and thou. Come on. And, you know, Dalai Lama himself says, you know, everything should evolve, including religion. Buddhism should evolve, according to Dalai Lama. And I wouldn't doubt this new pope feels the same way, too. Now, I've got nothing against religion. In fact, I love all world religions. And I love them with the idea that they were all founded on the great principles of loving one another. That's a golden rule. It's within all world's religions. And so once we start doing that and start working to evolve, it'll be a better place. Most of these churches, you know, I think there was something like 350,000 churches in the United States, and there's something like, you know, maybe 500,000 or 600,000 homeless people. Well, if each church would take a homeless person or two and help them out in the right way, instead of wanting to build a bigger church or get a better car for their pastor, then we probably wouldn't have a problem. You know, we could fix things. And I would love to see more churches and more people step up and do things like that. You know?
Isn't that what the churches truly should be representing, is that very message that, you know, these doors are open, you have a place to stay, or you have support? And I would think that should be somehow incorporated in a program. And I agree with what you said a minute ago, that in the very near future, there's a plan that has been laid out, right? And when we all get in alignment, in harmony with the plan, life becomes very, very easy. There's no struggle. And for those who will continue to operate from the old paradigm, things can get pretty tough, because, you know, you can possibly get left behind, so to speak. You become obsolete, just like everything else in the computer world, the technology world. Well, we are spiritual technology, and that technology is upgrading itself. And so we need to be a little more in touch with the computer program, spirit, whatever you want to call it, whatever word you choose is fine. But so we can at least advance ourselves along with the program, or people will be said left behind.
It's great that you're using the word program. This is awesome because television, they call it programming, and it literally programs your brain to thinking and feeling and acting in fear. Now, take a look. They've made it so you can't show lovemaking on TV, but you can show murder and rape and crazy things are allowed, but you can't show lovemaking. And so there's no true connection. There's people don't connect because their examples, monkey see, monkey do, the examples are really bad. And so all the cartoons are argumentative. And it goes back, you know, to the Honeymooners TV show, and then it turned into the Flintstones, and then it turned into on and on and on to where we've got a dysfunctional man and a functional woman, and they're in conflict all the time. It makes for good writing and storytelling, but you know, the Simpsons and on and on and on, we keep portraying these people, and there's programming these people to be actually normally stupid. Doesn't make sense, does it?
You know, we should call it tell lie vision.
Yeah.
Tell lie vision. I had a friend of mine some years ago, he and I were going to a movie, and he was telling me he read this pretty phenomenal book about how all these different word usages, they have alternate meanings. And we were actually walking into theater, and he was giving me an example. He said, for example, Keith, what do you read on that door? I said, entrance. He said, well, you're going into a movie theater, and they're going to be doing lots of advertising, because now read it by break the two syllables in half. And it was in trance.
Mm-hmm. In trance. Well, you know, all these words, they call it spelling. But in the old days, what a spell was casting a spell on someone. And if you look at the words,
wow,
or the term spelling,
phenomenal.
We're casting spells on people. And there's all sorts of little good ones, though, like religion, reconnect. And here's what it connects: our body, our mind, and our spirit. In most religion, we don't even consider, we talk about, oh, Jesus, or we talk about God, but we don't talk about this Holy Spirit as much. And the Holy Spirit is part of what we're evolving to. Well, what is the Holy Spirit? What is the Spirit? That makes no sense to most people because they're so rooted in the body, or they're so rooted in their mind and their ego, which is in the mind, that they don't even consider the rest of the equation. And the rest of the equation is sort of they talk about near-death experiences or doing certain drugs that'll take you to a level to where you get to see the observer. You get to observe that there's something observing the mind. We think the mind is the observer, and that's the leader, and because it's observing all the time. But there's something else beyond the mind, which is your Holy Spirit. The Spirit, that's the universal part of ourselves that's connected to all. And that's the part that when we realize that and reconnect to that, our religion gets to be deeper, a three-dimensional religion of body, mind, and spirit, whatever that is. And so once you start to explore that, you realize just like art or juggling or math, you can always add another ball. There's always more to learn. And if you do this radio show until the day you die, you'll still be learning every day that you do it from new things, because there's new ways all the time. That's why I call my thing newways.com.
Dig it.
You know, there's always more to learn. And quite often I see these people that, you know, they turn 40, 50, 60 years old, and then they know everything. Well, they don't know anything. Once you actually connect to your spirit, you realize, I don't know anything. I am just this infinite consciousness that's here to learn lessons and grow. and to evolve in the process. And so in the process of learning and growing, you make mistakes, you fumble forward. Dalai Lama is learning right now, and the Pope are learning right now how to age. There's another guy named Ram Dass. He's learning how to age. And he was a big spiritual guru who actually created LSD, went into spirituality that way. Eventually, he left all the drugs behind and realized that he could get higher by actually meditating, by connecting to nature, by connecting to what was in his heart and not what was in his head. And so then he wrote great books and did all these speakings for years, Ram Dass. And at some point, you'd think, oh, he knows everything. He doesn't. Once he got a stroke, and he said he got stroked. Once he got stroked and started losing his health, he learned even more. And so he's made some great films and books. One was called Fierce Grace. I highly recommend it.
Yes. And, have you seen the documentary about his life?
I've seen parts of information. I haven't seen the whole one. What is that also called Fierce Grace?
I think it is, bro.
Okay.
And if not, I'll look it up and I'll definitely send you a link to it. I dug it so much.
Cool. We were talking earlier about, do you have any techniques to help you in the morning, you know, when you're feeling weird or whatever, do you have any techniques to help you? And at all times, I use the same technique. I'm doing it right now. And I highly recommend everybody listening to do this. If you have a mirror near you, do it. If you're just walking around, start smiling. The idea is to smile and feel the feeling of that smile. Feel what happens to your entire body once you start off forcing a smile, just faking one. And the fake smile actually will start a chemical change to happen in your body that you start to release the tension in your neck and your shoulders and your back. Everything starts to let go because you're in connection to nature, into your natural way of being. If you were a kid, you would just be smiling and laughing most of the time because that's human nature, is to smile and to connect and to breathe and to play and to have fun. And so most people get into this system that we were talking about earlier, and they get so attached to the system, you know, trying to make money that they don't need at a job they hate, so that they can impress people with their new stuff that they don't even like, you know, and with their new stuff. And so they get into these systems, and they get out of nature, out of their own connection with who they really are. And so I go back to the smiling thing, and I fake the smile at first, and then I start to feel it. And once I feel it, the smile becomes genuine. And this goes when I'm actually still laying in bed. I start telling myself, my life is perfect. Even when it's not perfect, I say my life is perfect because every problem is really an opportunity for me to learn and grow. So if I have a problem, what am I learning and growing from it? So I realize, what's the problem? What's the lesson in this? And so I keep smiling, telling myself it's all perfect, working through my problems if I can, and smiling, smiling, smiling. And then when I go out, that smile is contagious because everything's contagious. My fear is contagious. My anger is contagious. My smiles are contagious. My laughter is contagious. And so it's a choice, yum or yuck, at every point of your life. And so when you're feeling yum, you get to share the yum and it comes bouncing back to you. Does that all make sense?
I love it. Keith Anthony Blanchard here, your host of Center of Light Radio, 6 p.m. Eastern Time, Monday nights. Tonight, my guest is Mr. Brian Hardin. Brian, would you give out your contact information? Then I want to start the second half of the show, something you and I have been itching to do.
Okay, well, my contact information, my name is Brian David Hardin, Brian, B-R-I-A-N, David, D-A-V-I-D, Hardin. And there's another Brian Hardin in Nashville that is he claims to be the real Brian Hardin, but I've got other whatever. He and I actually shared the same profession. I lived in Nashville for many years and recorded all this music for many, many years of my life. And Christian music, country music, and rock music, pop music, rap music, R&B, and so on for many years. And I've recorded about 120 gold records in my life. And so I love to make things and play. And now I've transitioned into also adding things like a video and film, and writing more, and now speaking more. And I did puppet shows for MTV. I've done two films with the Dalai Lama, two films with these Mayan elders, two films with these Hopi Indians, and a bunch of other weird little things. So BrianDHardin.com. There's also newways.com. Now, the Brian D. Hardin is more of like the music making guy and the filmmaking guy. The new ways is what I'm evolving into, is helping people to evolve their consciousness. And it's really me evolving my consciousness. In the process, I get to share what I'm learning. And I do not know everything. In fact, although my mom would probably tell you differently, but I don't. I'm just muddling my way through, just like everybody else on the planet. But I'm doing it with a big smile on my face, like you are. And I'm trying to play more and not think as much, but use my heart as the leader. And one of the things I say on newways.com, with a K-N-E-W-W-A-Y-S.com, is to laugh more, worry less, love all, and do it with gratitude for everything, including those problems, because they're all just lessons. And I added recently a couple things to the front of it, which was question everything and fear nothing. And so the second half, maybe we can start questioning things and fearing nothing. Because I know you talk about some pretty edgy topics like aliens and how they're helping with the evolution of consciousness.
Keith Anthony Blanchard here with Center of Light Radio to remind you about my lifelong work, RPM, Recognize, Plug In, and Manifest Your Life. Let me ask you a few questions. What is it you want out of your life? You want more financial stability? You want relationship? You want greater degrees of bliss, conscious expansion, and spiritual evolvement? These are magnificent, wonderful things, and I have achieved all of these by implementing what I am offering to you, so you can apply this to your life, so you can have all those things that you truly desire and truly deserve. I absolutely guarantee my work 100%. Go to Center of Light Radio, look at the opening page, the bottom right-hand corner of your screen. Not only will you receive my awesome Power Pack newsletter monthly, but you will have access to my RPM program. Stay in touch with me, and I will send you everything I'm about, all my successful works. You can bet. All you have to do is contact me, KeithAnthonyBlanchard@gmail.com. Peace, love, and light to you always. I recently did a Burst of Light feed last week about what's really happening, quote, out there. And that out there is not that far away. Now, if anyone is doing the research a lot about what's going on the dark side of the moon, what's happening there, wow. You know, I come to realize, and I came across recently a diamond of information about cosmic disclosure. 22 alien civilizations on the dark side of the moon, governments from all over our world up there. The Germans were first in space. It wasn't America. It wasn't the Russians. The Germans made contact with reptilians. And this thing, there's just a lot. It's a big old pie. But I do believe completely that there are beings here assisting in every possible way. But one thing is they cannot do is violate our free will. Now, they can indirectly coax us, but they can't make certain calls. They can't break protocol. And they will all tell you that, from people who channel the Pleiades, people who work with the whoever's and the whoever's and the whoever's. They all have a common message, and that message is they will not violate humanity's free will of choice.
Fantastic. About a month ago, I was with David Wilcock at an event where he was talking about all this stuff. Are you familiar with David Wilcock at all?
Yeah. In fact, Cosmic Disclosure, the program I told you that I found all the information, it is his show.
Good. Yeah, he's pretty much on the cutting edge of a lot of this. There's also a guy named Corey Good that is part of a lot of the information. Yes. Now, I don't know what to think about all of it because, you know, everybody's a person and we're all getting our information for different things. So, you know, when I said I've added a couple things, question everything and fear nothing.
Right.
So, I question what he's saying, and I also question the other thing, which is what he's saying to question. So I question everything, you know, you know, that he's sometimes I'm right in life and sometimes I'm wrong. And same with him. He might be right 93% of the time, but the 7% that he's wrong, you know, still exists. I don't know. I don't know what all this is, but I do know that when we think of our little planet as the only place in the world, and that the further we look out, we're looking out into billions of light years away, meaning the light takes billions of years to get to us. Yeah. I can't wrap my head around that size. And for me to think, that Jesus made this whole place here with billions of light years just for our little planet just doesn't make any sense to me. Yeah. You know, that there are there has to be other beings out there. There has to be. And I went to a Southern Baptist University in Nashville called Belmont College, and I got to question everything there. And I got to question everything I believed, everything I didn't believe. And I learned a lot. And the minister there wrote the book for the Southern Baptist ministers to use at all the universities. And he was my professor for 2 years. And he and I had great conversations in his office where he would talk about mind-bending things that most ministers couldn't approach. And so if you only believe what, you know, let's say the Bible says or whatever else, I say, please question everything and start looking beyond and looking into the Holy Spirit side of things and see if there's what the observer is really saying to you. And there's other layers to all of us. And so once we turn our mind off and turn our body needs off and we start to connect to that spirit, we start to feel that there's more to all of us, that universal consciousness or that heaven on earth is a plane that we're all connected on. And that plane that we're all connected on is this energy of universal consciousness. That's our spirit. That's where our spirit rides. And that's where our connection to other worlds and other beings resides. I'm sorry to go on, but you know, in the physical world, you know, we had the Industrial Revolution. That only happened 150 years ago. And if before the Industrial Revolution, before we discovered electricity, if I would have told you that we were going to capture the energy of lightning bolts and send it down wires and put it into your house so that you had the light of the sun in the middle of the night, you would think I was crazy. And then same thing with the mental revolution.
I would think you were Tesla.
Yeah. Well, and then the mental revolution of the information age, some body was all the physical stuff. If I would have told you we were going to fly, it was crazy talk. And then the information age that we were all going to have a little black box in our hands, you know, called the iPhone or whatever, that we were going to be able to get the information of the world in a millisecond from, you'd think I was crazy. Well, that's the physical stuff. That's the mental stuff. Our next revolution or evolution is the spiritual revolution or evolution. And the spiritual evolution has everything to do with things that feel absolutely crazy to us now. This crazy talk of aliens isn't going to be crazy soon. And other dimensions aren't going to be crazy. I personally believe that in our lifetime, we might change the way that we live 70 or 80 years and live a lot longer, we might also be able to change our energy like Jesus to be able to walk on water by changing our energy field and our belief systems. Our physical and our mental things change once we tune into the spiritual, and then suddenly we're walking on water. We're doing miracles. And so all of this evolution of consciousness, to me, is going to start to seem like miracles to the people that are programmed into that old narrow-minded system.
I think the cosmos is about to come down the pike and start revealing itself in ways people never imagine. In fact, what you said, sir, was really, really cool, because I just found something from the Divine Principle. Not because it's my book. Yay, yay, shameless plug. It's because it does make and support the point you made. This book was written from the premise that God and I, or my higher self, whatever you want to call it, having a dialogue. In this one particular paragraph, it says, "I tell you again that if humanity were in alignment with the divine will, it would not be in its present condition. But rest assured, this condition will be corrected early in the new millennium. That is when the entire world will find itself submerged in absolute God change. And that is when it will become mandatory for everyone to question everything you believe to be true. As you all meditate upon the enigma of God, you will have no choice but to re-examine what you think is divine."
Wow, that's fantastic. Wow.
Yeah, you know, I think
it's important to fear nothing on top of that. Remember that one, right?
Absolutely. And I think it's purposeful that it's that way, that it's laid out that way, because we can't really expand. We can't move into our new territory, spiritual territory, as long as we're in the box. If magic is not happening in the box, the walls of the box have to come down.
You know, the TV programming programs us to fear. The movies program us to fear. The law system, the government. We need a mommy. Oh, you know, no, we don't. In religion, you know, a lot of versions of religion are fear-based. You know, God, my God is not a punishing, judgmental God. Jesus said, love one another. He said, you know, do unto others as you would have done to you. He wasn't saying, take the eye for, you know, before the other guy takes your eye. He was saying, you know, and so, you know, with all of these systems, they've been half truths, and our economy is a half truth. You know, we think, oh, well, this is the way it's always been. Money, 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 power, business. It's just the way we do business. And we've always done it this way. Well, we haven't. If you look back in history, we haven't done it that way all the time. And there's cultures, plenty of cultures that are still going right now that don't rely on money as the driving force for them. And like in Bhutan, the entire country talks about gross national happiness, not gross national product. I was with the one guy from the leader from Bhutan, along with a woman named Vedanta Shiva, and we were in Mexico City last year, and we wrote the rights of Mother Earth in June of last year, and it's now been instituted that it will be instituted this year in Mexico. And it's coming, this new evolution of giving the earth rights. I'm making music. Last week, I was making music with this kid named Juteska Martinez, who sued the U.S. government for climate change, saying that he and all the children of the world and the people of the world have rights to life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness, and nature is part of that, and that they have rights to nature, and that you can't just continually destroy it for economic reasons. And so he and I were making music last week, and he spoke at the United Nations three times so far. He's 16 years old. And last week, he also won a court decision in Colorado saying that, yes, nature does have its rights. And that's happening around the world, not only in Mexico City and here, but other places around the world are now saying rivers have rights and so on, that the water is life. And so this is part of the waking up of consciousness. We have a choice of two paths of money, greed, ego, fear. That's the mind stuff. The mind controls creating ego, fear, and needing lack and money and power, and then the heart is the more the feminine, and that's the love. That's instead of about me, it's about we. It's about being connected to what's good for all, for nature, and being in harmony with nature. So when they say universe, one song, the harmony is yes. is. The harmony of us tuning into nature and the natural ways the planets are evolving with the sun, the moon, and so on. I mean, when there's a full moon, everybody responds differently, you know, and there's more bizarre behavior. Well, same thing with the way our solar system is moving through these other systems. We're changing and evolving with not only our little solar system is not just spinning around itself, it's moving
through space at thousands of miles per hour.
Yeah, it's actually mind bending. And that is helping us evolve because as the frequency of our solar system changes, the frequency of our sun changes, and the frequency of us, including the plants and the animals. And it sounds crazy talk, but it's not. The animals are becoming more conscious. We're becoming more conscious. And this is no accident that we are thinking more of we. And if you really read about the Mayan calendar, you'll realize, oh, what they were talking about is this evolution in consciousness. It wasn't the end of the world. It was the end of the world as we know it. The old paradigm was ending, and this new paradigm was going to show up. We sang back in the 70s, this is the dawning of the age of Aquarius.
Yeah, right.
And we are now in this, and what that means is every 2,000 or so years, we switch from one system to another, and it's one sign, one astrological sign to another. And so we were in the sign of Pisces for over 2,000 years, and Pisces is a fish right side up and then another fish upside down. And Jesus represented that fish too. Imagine that. And no accident. And so with these Pisces fish upside down and right side up, it's about judgment. I'm good, you're bad. What was Jesus's message? Don't judge. Love one another. Well, we judged and hated each other and created war for 2,000 years. So now this evolution of consciousness is we've moved into this Aquarian age for another 2,000 years or so, 2,100 years or whatever. And this Aquarian age is about water. It's about flow. It's the feminine attribute of the heart. It's about we. It's about our connection to nature. And so guess what? We're doing it. We're connecting to our spirit, totally. Turning our mind off and letting our spirit connect to your heart and your body. And so when you're playing guitar and all those scales that you learned and now you have the physical ability to do those without thinking, then your spirit gets to play those chords and things and magic happens. Same thing here. Right. Magic is going to happen because information's at our fingertips. We don't need the mind information anymore. It's in the Google phone. It's in whatever. We don't need the information in our mind to take lead. We need our intuition, our creativity, or our heart to take lead. You know. And so, if you were an alien off planet, you'd be waiting for these dumb cavemen that are throwing war at each other to evolve past the war and start loving each other before you'd even show up here. Because you don't want to deal with idiots that want to create war with you. You want to be in harmony with everybody.
Have you seen the joke? It's pretty funny. If you can imagine two aliens sitting in rocking chairs on their home planet, and when they set off the nuclear bomb many, many years ago, the other one turns to, he says, uh-oh, the kids found the matches. We were talking about aliens, and we were talking about Jesus, and we were also talking about getting out of the box and ask questions. You and I batted this around, and some people actually chew in this idea in the movement that Jesus was an alien. Let's talk about that a little bit and get your thoughts about that hot topic.
Well, I don't have direct proof of anything, but let's just think about this.
Ask the questions.
Well, let's just think about this. You know, when you look at Egypt and those big pyramids and stuff, and the pyramids in Mexico and all over the world, they're pyramids. And then what happened after the pyramids? Right here, and then you look at the world religions, the where they came from, and on and on, going back to, you know, things like Stonehenge and all these early things. And when you look at all these crazy mysteries of the world, you start to realize there's a lot of questions. So question everything. There we go back to that. Now, Jesus was a special being.
In that regard, he was, a quote, not like everyone else. He was an alien. Yeah.
And in fact, in the indigenous culture, they actually have stories of this fair-haired person coming to every Native American tribe from Alaska down to Chile, through South America, the whole way to Chile. All the tribes have these bizarre stories about a character similar to Jesus. Like in the Hopi thing, they call it Masal. There's others in other cultures like Lakota and whatever else, but they all talk about this being coming and helping them evolve. And so whether Jesus was, his details don't matter to me. What matters is the message, and the message is universal in every world religion. It's also in all of that Native American culture. If you look at the Native American symbol, it's to connect to all. They have this thing called the four directions. It's got red, white, black, and yellow as the four colors. It's a circle cut up into little four pie slices, and there's red, white, black, and yellow. Well, what are the root races of all the people on the planet? Red, white, black, and yellow.
Right.
So when the Lakota say, we honor all directions, and we honor all relations, to all our relations, Matakwiasin. When we honor all that, we're saying we love everybody as an equal, everything as an equal. And that connection not only goes to the people and the root races, but to the planet itself and to nature itself. So the leader of the Mayans, the Mayan high priest, talks about Mayas aren't little guys from Guatemala. Mayans are energy beings from the stars. We're all made of stars. And that there are black Mayans, red Mayans, white Mayans, and yellow Mayans. And that you are indeed Maya. You are energy from the stars. We're made from the stars. So there was a Catholic priest that I did an interview with. In fact, you can find him on that New Ways, KNEWWAYS.com. This interview with this guy named Father Charlie Moore. And he spoke about aliens all the time. And he spoke about Jesus was an alien in his own way. And he was a Catholic priest, and he I did a great interview with him, and he said that we're all changing with the light and the energy of the sun, but that as the sun evolves, we all evolve too. And yes, Jesus was probably or possibly an extraordinary being and could be from another time, space, shapeshift. I don't
Absolutely.
Know. Could be. I question everything. But I do know that the feeling and the love and the energy of Jesus is within me. And so I feel the energy of Jesus. I don't question what his past was. I just listen to the message of love. And that's what I want. You know, love.
That's awesome, bro. I dig it. Brian, we are slowly but surely coming to the top of the hour. And I appreciate you being a backup guest because the difficulties I had getting my original planned guest here in the show. Would you leave us with a final thought? And again, close out with your web contacts for our listening audience so you can find more about you and what you're doing, sir.
Wow, I don't even have a final thought. I have no idea what this is going to come out as. And that's the exciting that's the exciting part of life. I have no idea what I'm going to do as soon as we hang up the phone. I'll probably go do something to have fun. I'll play. I'll enjoy myself. I'll work on evolving my consciousness and connecting with what brings myself and others some level of growth and love. So, I guess. What could I tell you?
You know, Brian, I'm actually going to be launching a new project soon, a big one too. I'm going to produce a movie called I Am Memphis Music, a documentary about the Memphis musical heart, people who, musicians are everywhere in Memphis, guitar players, dime a dozen, phenomenal musicians, but it's about those who put their entire life into bringing music to the community, but also about those people who are using their gift and their talent of music to change people's lives. People in Memphis do benefits all the time. And I thought about this when you're talking about some of the projects you were doing, some of these films that you're doing. Boy, I would sure love in the future you and I to get together and make a bunch of noise.
Well, yeah, I love making music. I have a studio in the back that's an analog 16 track. I've got two digital studios here too, and you know, every real drums and piano and all the real stuff, and I make music every day. In fact, when we hang up, I'll probably work on a little bit of music. I'll play some basketball. We'll have some fun. But I always say, question everything, fear nothing, laugh more, worry less, love all, and do it with gratitude for everything, even the bad stuff, because they're all, even the bad stuff is just lessons. It's all just lessons we're learning. So if you're having a bad day, wait a little while. You'll eventually have a good day. And if you're having a good day, wait a little while. You'll eventually have a bad day. And it's just the roller coaster of life. So life's either a roller coaster or a treadmill. It's your choice. Choose wisely.
Brian, phenomenal guest, everyone. Mr. Brian David Hardin sitting in for Mr. Rydahl, who cannot make it tonight. Brian, I appreciate you, sir. Thank you greatly.
Thank you so much. And I really admire all the work that you're doing. Thank you. I love you.
Man, you're welcome. You know, it's like when I talk to you, it's like looking in a mirror, talking to myself and playing it back, because I really see so much of myself in you and vice versa.
Thank you. Thank you. Greatly.
Thank you, brother. I'll be in touch soon. You can bet.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Everyone, Mr. Brian Hardin. I love this cat. I love his passion. You can hear it. And if you can't hear it, next week on Center of Light Radio, my guest is going to be Andre Atabaki. This cat is, I love this cat. Sort of reminds me of Brian. Get on YouTube and look up The Bible of Mithra. It's about an hour long. This video is so finely done. Andre Atabaki. Make sure you're here for that show, 6 p.m. Eastern Time here on Center of Light Radio. My name is Keith Anthony Blanchard, your host. I appreciate you greatly. When you lay down at night and you really have nothing to do, might as well do something. Breathing, you do it all the time, all day long, right? It's not hard, right? Now just become conscious of that breath. Stay with that breath. Taste that breath. Salivate over that breath. Breathe passionately. And I promise you, 10, 15 minutes of that, when you break through the ceiling of thought, wow. You will hear the profound, deafening silence that has always been there, that will guide your life. Check this out. While you're listening to my voice, the part of you that's taking in the sounds of my voice, that is the real you. That's the you that's always been aware. It's the you that's aware now, and it's the you that will live forever. And when you get in touch with who you are through meditation, I promise you, and you begin to experience that kind of eternity in your life. Keith Anthony Blanchard, peace, love, and light. I'll see you next Monday night. Peace and bliss.